Welcome to today's lecture on the topic Mechanical Methods of Cell Disruption. So in the last lecture we have studied about homogenization, homogenizer, and I have already solved a problem also on homogenizer. So today we will see some more methods of which comes under the mechanical method of cell disruption, that is ball mill and ultrasonication. So coming to the table of contents, we'll discuss two important methods under mechanical methods of cell disruption, bead mill and coming to bead mill disruption technique. So let me show you a horizontal type of bead mill disruption technique. So this is the bead mill system that we have, the horizontal type. So let me first explain the construction of this system. So you can see there you have a horizontal system here which has impeller blades and the rotating shaft. So with this help of the shaft and the impeller, this impeller will be continuously rotating in the system, which helps in the mixing of the beads with the cells. And the cell suspension is sent from inlet here, and you can see there is a jacketed system which helps in maintaining the temperature. So to cool down the system due to the heat generated inside, the jacketed system have been incorporated. And these are the bead materials which are used inside. These are inert materials which might be made up of either alumina, it might be made up of titanium, etc. So this kind of bead material will help in collision between the cells and the beads. And this collision will lead to grinding between the bead and the cell, which leads to breaking up of the cell and releasing the contents. And finally, the cell suspension, which is broken down, that is your product, is coming out from this outlet. So similarly, we can have vertical systems. So this is a typical example of a vertical system of ball mill system or the bead mill system. So you can see here in this particular case, you have the homogenized cell coming out here, right? And this is the cell suspension which is coming out in here. So these are the cells, and these are the, again, the impeller blades, and all other things remain the same, but just that the construction is a vertical type. So in this particular case, you might require more energy, as I told you, because you can see here cell is coming from down and you have to mix it within the system. So you require more energy to mix here compared to the horizontal system. So in that way, energy requirement for a vertical system might be much higher in comparison with the horizontal system. And you can see the other construction parts same as the previous diagram we saw: cooling jacket, beads, rotating shaft, impeller blades. So all other things remain the same. So coming to the working of this, so you have the system, you have the beads, and you have the cell. Okay, so cell slurry with you. So you can see the RPM at which this bead mill usually rotates. So it is high RPM, around 1500 to 2250 RPM. So in this range, this bead mill works, and the bead diameter is usually in 0.2 to 1 mm range. Okay, so these are the beads and these are the cells. So coming to the cell concentration, again we have to optimize the condition for how much bead is required and how much cell suspension is required in this experiment. So that will be on the trial and error basis. And for a particular case, these are the readings. So RPM of 1500 to 250 RPM, bead diameter of 0.2 to 1 mm, and cell suspension of 30 to 60% weight solids. So as these beads and cells are getting mixed within the bead mill, there is a continuous collision and grinding which is happening between the cells and the beads, which leads to breaking up of the cell and releasing of the contents. So we saw the horizontal and vertical type of cell disruption here. And as I told you, the bead is made up of wear resistant material, which is made up of either glass, alumina, titanium carbide, zirconium oxide, etc. So the cell suspension is pumped into the cylinder, as I showed you, and it is agitated in the system at a high speed, which leads to shear forces. So this is the most important thing that you are supposed to understand, that the shear forces between the cells and the beads will lead to collision and grinding. So to show the mechanism how it works, this diagram will make it even easier. So this is the cross section of that same vertical bead mill system. So you can see here I have my impeller blades and the shaft system here. So you can see here within this inside what happens is the shear force between the bead and the cell. So the bead and the cell will start colliding. So that is shown here. You can see here collision between two beads. So these dark ones are my beads and this is my cell. So you can see the cell gets collided with the beads and it gets grinded between the beads. Because of this collision and grinding due to the shear forces there, the cells will break apart and the contents will get released. So this is the basic mechanism by which it works. So coming to the rate and degree of disruption, it depends on various factors like the nature of microorganisms, like whether the size of the organism. So we have seen the complexity of the organisms. So if you remember the gram positive, gram negative, the nature is different. So based on that, again, you may require multiple passes through the system, or you may require more beads for grinding. So in that way, it depends. The concentration or composition of the cell wall also matters. The concentration also matters. And the location of the product, whether the product is present in the cytoplasm, periplasmic space, or within the organelles. So if it is within the organelles, it will require more energy. If it is in the cytoplasm, it might require slightly less energy, but periplasmic will require even less energy. So based on the cell structure or the location of the product, you can again classify it. Based on the beads, like what is the size of the beads, what is the loading rate, that also has to be considered. The residence time, so this is nothing but how much time I require into the system so that all the cells that I've introduced in the system gets broken apart and the contents get released. The temperature of the system matters, because we know our cells are very sensitive, and if temperature is not maintained properly, the quality of the product can get hampered. So in that way, even temperature has to be considered, and the type of impeller and agitation speed. So I showed you a typical example of particular speed that is used. Similarly, for different cells that you're using, the speed might change. So we have seen about plant cells, right? So plant cells are more rigid. So if you're trying to use a ball mill system for plant cells, definitely the agitation speed will be much higher. So coming to the advantages of horizontal bead mill over vertical type, so we have seen that the horizontal system has higher bead loading capacity in comparison with the vertical type. And you have uniform distribution of beads in the system, and it requires low energy. So coming to the second system that we have, that is the ultrasonication systems, here the cell is suspended or subjected to ultrasonic vibrations. So this is the most important thing. We are using an ultrasonic vibration system, and the frequency range which is commonly used is 18 to 25 kilohertz. So by forcing the cell suspension through an emission tip, so you have a system where you have a cell suspension and you have an ultrasonic probe, we'll see that, and it works at a high frequency. So this high frequency is generated electronically by means of electric generator. We have something called as ultrasound electric generator, which helps in the creation of this ultrasounds. So this will power the transducer, so which will convert the electrical energy to mechanical energy. So we need some vibrations there so that the cells get this ultrasound waves and leads to breaking up of the cell. So the electric generator will generate the electric energy, that is the ultrasound electric energy, which is then converted to mechanical energy, that is the movement, by means of a transducer. So this entire system can be done using a piezoelectric crystal. So using this piezoelectric crystal, these kind of ultrasonic waves are generated. So this is a typical diagram, so how it looks like. So you can see a particular frequency of 18 kilohertz is used here for the lysis of the cell. So this is my cell suspension, and this is my ultrasound generator. So this will create ultrasound, and that ultrasonic waves are sufficient enough to disrupt the cell and release the contents. So that is by cavitation. So this is the mechanism by which it works. So due to the shock waves there, so the cavitation followed by shock waves will lead to disruption of cell. So bacterial cells, typically if you're trying to use the system, a very less time is sufficient, around 30 to 60 seconds is sufficient, but yeast cells are more rigid compared to bacterial cells, so there you may require 2 to 10 minutes. So this is how you can try to use an ultrasound system for breaking open the cell. And in some cases, they have seen that the heat transfer problems are there in the systems, and these are usually operated in batch mode. So these are the few limitations of the system. So if you can try to encounter these limitations, definitely this will be a good choice for cell disruption. So we have seen that the mechanical energy is transmitted to the sample through the probe that oscillates at high frequency. And due to the cavitation and impaction, that is nothing but it is called as the microbubble formation. So due to this cavitation and impaction, there is cell disruption that is happening within the system. So the duration of the ultrasound, so how much time I require, and what is the ultrasound energy that I should use, it depends on the cell concentration and the sample that you're using. So whether I'm using bacteria, whether I'm using yeast sample, so based on that, definitely my time is going to change based on the complexity of the cell wall and based on how much concentration I'm adding into the system. So if I'm using a less concentration, I may require less time and less energy. But if I'm using more concentration of cells, then I require more time and more energy. So it is as simple as that. So coming to the probes that we have, there are something called as small probes and large probes. So smaller probes, so we have seen this, the probes. So these probes that are used can be of smaller probe type or larger probe type. So if there are smaller probe, they cause excellent cavitation, which is good enough to break open the cell. But larger probes, they can handle large volume of sample, but it does not produce so much intense cavitation. So if you have a comparison, if you think of alternatives between small probes and larger probes, smaller probes are a better choice compared to larger probes. That is why they are always using this system most of the time in batch modes, because in batch modes you can try to use small probes, have excellent cavitation, break open the cell and get your contents released. So coming to the disadvantage of this system, as I told you, heat generated during the system, heat dissipation can lead to product damage to some extent in some cases. So that has to be taken care. High noise level. So you might have worked with ultrasonication systems. You know that there's a lot of noise created here. So if there are systems which are having enclosure systems so that the sound which is generated there does not emit out to that extent, then these kind of sonic enclosures for the system, if they have introduced, then that would be a good choice. And most of the times they have seen this kind of problems of yield variability. That means if I use the system once, I get a particular yield. Next time when I use a same system, there might be a slightly change in the yield. So the conditions has to be optimized. So a lot of experimentation has to be done to get this, that yield becomes almost same. And once you have optimized the conditions, if you use the system, definitely this problem can be encountered. So one more important disadvantage of this system is it is not applicable for industrial scale. As I told you, the smaller probes are better and the batch system is better. And that is because they've seen that in the systems few times the free radicals are generated. Okay, so these are not good. We know that free radicals can create problems in the system. So if these kind of free radicals are generated when you use an ultrasound system, then it can become a difficult or a not required situation. So in that way, this might not be used widely in industrial scale, but for lab scale experiments, for disruption, this is a good choice. So coming to the disadvantages of the mechanical disruption. So we have already seen about homogenization, ball mill system and ultrasonication. So let me put a slide on what are the disadvantages of these mechanical disruption systems, so that once you understand this, we can study about the non-mechanical methods of cell disruption in my next lecture. So coming to the disadvantage of mechanical disruption, we know there is heat dissipation problem. So this is the most important thing. The heat which is created in the system, and jacketed system to some extent will reduce the heat, but most of the time, even after using the jacketed system, they are not capable enough to reduce the heat to that extent, so that your product may not get denatured. Okay, so to some extent some kind of denaturation is seen. So this is one major problem which has to be encountered. Product contamination. So most of the times when you use a mechanical method of cell disruption, what happens is the whole cell gets ruptured. So this is one issue, the whole cell rupturing, because of which you may get multiple products within your system, which needs to have more and more DPT steps to get the individual products from that. So that will require again more energy. So that is one issue with mechanical cell disruption techniques. And coming to optimum release. So that might require more than one pass. So we have seen an example of homogenizer. We have seen that it requires four passes, five passes. So based on that, the energy release or the product release might require more passes through the system, which might indirectly increase the energy requirement, and indirectly it will definitely increase the DPT cost. And scaling up is sometimes difficult in this kind of mechanical methods. So that's it for today, guys. Thank you for listening to me, and please subscribe the channel for more updates. Thank you.